Hi, everyone. Welcome. My name is Madi Robles. I'm the executive director at Headlands Center for the Arts, which is located in Sausalito, California. And I just want to welcome you to Brooklyn to this wonderful and special event that we are going to get started. Before I introduce our speakers, I'm going to talk a little bit about why we're here today in this borough. About a year ago, we started to prep for what would mark our 40th anniversary celebrations. And through that process, we realized that of our 2000 plus Headlands alum, outside of the Bay Area, we have the most alumni in New York City in the five boroughs. So we decided to, we decided immediately that it would be a good idea to hit the road with this celebration. And I just want to thank you all for joining us. Can we start the PowerPoint? So as many of you know, Headlands was founded in the early 1980s, and it was founded by a group of artists who started to fix up these then derelict buildings in the Marin Headlands. And so I just wanted to situate us there, even though we are in a very different landscape right now. Headlands was always meant to be a space for breaking bread together, for getting into meaty discussions, and for recharging and finding inspiration in this gorgeous landscape. At the same time, we started to build out our residency program, and we invited artists from all over the globe to take up studio space in these buildings and to do performances like this one that's coming up by Joanna Haygood, who's a performance artist. This is the late 1980s in her studio, and it's a site for sort of experimental dance. We have artists from all different disciplines, like this one, who's a filmmaker, Veronique Guillot, who used our historic gym space to create part of her film in the late 80s. And then lastly, Mei Ling, this is an installation in one of our largest and most magical spaces. So I just, for those who haven't been to Headlands, we look forward to welcoming you the next time that you're in the Bay Area. But tonight we're celebrating all of the amazing artists and all of the amazing people that made and built Headlands into what it is today. An artist first, creativity forward space. And we're equally honoring our past as well as our future and the future generations to come. So there are a ton of people to thank. So if you'll bear with me, I wanna start by thanking our alumni artists, some who are in this room today, and some who are watching via our live stream on YouTube. Thank you for bringing your ingenuity and your passion to Headlands and for imagining what is possible with us. I also wanna thank several generous supporters, the Mellon Foundation, the Swain Family Foundation, and the Ruth Foundation for the Arts. And a special thank you to the Lower Manhattan Cultural Council for connecting us to Elizabeth Demaray, who I will introduce in just a minute. And to the entire BRIC Arts Media team, thank you for your help and hosting us today. I also want to give a special shout out to our entire board and staff, some who are with us today. So Letty Light, our current board chair, who's right here in the front. Letty, can you just give us a round of applause for Letty? And to our board members who traverse the country to be here, Tinsley and Dory, thank you so much. We really appreciate you joining us. Also want to give a special thanks to the 40th anniversary committee and to our honorary committee member, MJ Brown, who helped you at the door today, who's with us, and to our spectacular leader in these efforts, Anne Meisinger, who has been running around, and you may have received some emails from her. So all of this that you're experiencing today would not have been possible without her help. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our panel today, our artists, our phenomenal and generous artists who are with us. So first, Rodney Ewing, who's right over here, is an interdisciplinary artist whose works re-examine human stories and histories, cultural conditions, and trauma. Rodney was our resident, our artist in residence at Headlands in 2019, and is now sits on our board of directors. And Elizabeth Demaray, who is a sculptor who focuses on the interface between the built and natural environment. She's worn many hats at Headlands, and you'll probably hear about them today, including graduate fellow in 1999 and artist in residence in 2002. So with that, please join me in welcoming our conversation. So to begin, Rodney, I was wondering if you could start with you. I'd love it if you could just take a few minutes to tell us a little bit about your practice and what brought you to Headlands when you first arrived.
Thank you all for coming out, and thank you guys for having me here at Headlands. So my practice revolves around being interdisciplinary. I do works on paper, installations, and some sculptural works. And what brought me to Headlands, I had put in an application for just a regular residency and was sort of waiting to hear from that in December. And then I get this email come across my screen one day in September saying like, oh, would you like to have the project space? Like you even had to ask me like, would I want to do that? Of course. And there was a quick moment of panic. It was like, oh, what am I going to do with this like 1,000 square feet? And then I remembered some other projects that wouldn't fit in my studio. There was like logistical issues that if I would try to do this in my regular studio in San Francisco, that it wouldn't quite work. So I was able to bring those ideas to the Headlands. And I had been a big fan of Headlands in the past. I'd visited friends and other artists there that I really admired there, and they all had glowing praises about the Headlands. And I know with a residency, there's always this sort of catchphrase about time and space, but it's true. It's like having that kind of time to not feel rushed. Like I had a day job as a teacher, and not having to sort of have that as sort of background noise. It just helps you sort of develop in ways you didn't think possible. And coming to the Headlands and being able to do that was just, it changed a lot of things for me in my current practice.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
Yeah, so hi everybody. Hello. Thanks for coming and thank you for having us. I was just saying that I was at the Headlands a long time ago, 20 years ago. And I was telling these guys that the last alumni event I had been to in New York City, we just hung out in a bar. So yeah, amazing. This is lovely. So I'm a sculptor, but I'm very interested in our sort of cultural interactions with the natural world. So the pieces that I make often involve living systems. I'm particularly interested in what I like to call trans-species giving, things that us humans can do to support the natural world. And I'm sort of interested in like the poetics of action. So I came to the Headlands. I'm from the Bay Area. I grew up in the Bay Area. I didn't think I was gonna go to graduate school in art. It was kind of a surprise. So I sort of was a late, transfer into sort of the art world. And I had finished my MFA at Berkeley. And I was flat broke. I had no idea what I was gonna do for a job, you know? And they had just started this amazing thing called a Postgraduate Studio Award Fellowship. And it was competitive. And I just remember thinking, wow, if I could get that, that would be amazing. Because the Headlands was like magical. I remember going out there through the tunnel and it was a beautiful space, and the art, you know, the studios were beautiful. I just couldn't even imagine it, and I got it. And it was really, just to have that kind of support at that moment in my career was just amazing. The fact that a lot of the artists that are there are international or from all over the United States was a really interesting kind of portal onto sort of like what the rest of the art world was. So and all of the support and all the space was just really extraordinary. It's an amazing experience.
It's great. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit, you have, both of you have done a number of residencies. And so I'm wondering if you could talk about how Headlands, it's just what marked Headlands residency for you?
Me first, yeah. Oh boy. Yeah, you know, I have. We were just talking about the fact, my husband's here tonight, and we have a 13-year-old, and I was just saying that after you have kids, it's really difficult to go to residencies. I was really fortunate. I got to go to Skowhegan in the middle of graduate school. I remember we were talking about that felt a little bit more like summer camp, but like kind of intense art summer camp. The Headlands was, it was a completely different situation because it's a community of people and you have the time and the space when you're there, like the physical space. You can go, you know, out on walks, you can be contemplative, you can do your work. And then in the evenings you come and you have these beautiful dinners with people. And it just, and it's the exchange of ideas is extraordinary. I think because, you know, you have artists, you know, visual artists, writers, musicians. It's just this wide range of, you know, makers. Yeah, so it's just a beautiful balance. It makes everything kind of even. You know, it evens out sort of your day. Yeah, just lovely.
What about you, Rodney?
I think I'd also have to say community as well. When I got there, I knew when the announcements came out, a really good friend of mine from the Bay Area was also going to be in my cohort. My next door neighbor in the studio actually had in San Francisco. She was going to be there. And so I already felt like, you know, I'm going someplace where I'm going to be comfortable. And then once I got there, it's just like, it was just even more reinforced because the cohort, people there are just so open and so friendly, and you kind of learn things about yourself as an artist, but you also, I think there's always this question within artist's head, like, how should I be as an artist? And I think when you're around a cohort like that, you get those examples, like how you can be as an artist, how you can function as an artist, like whether it's just resources or just philosophy or just, hey, slow down. Don't take a hammer and chisel to that piece yet. You know, there's a reason why you built that first one that way. And so like, here's some advice from like somebody who's down the hall from you. And just, you know, you're living with people, like, you know, and I know we got into a routine in the doghouse in the morning where Corey Newkirk and Naeem Brown, we would just like hang out and talk for like at least an hour before we all sort of just went our separate ways, and we didn't see each other until like dinner time. And then, you know, there's dinner and there's discussions, and then there's, you know, the discussion goes back to somebody's house. And so that sense of community, that really strong sense of community that's built into the Headlands residency is really distinctive.
Absolutely. I feel like we are just closing out at the Headlands our third session of Artists of Residence currently. And I have heard from a number of residents who say that part of the magic at Headlands is the depth of conversation that you can have. And I think that our residency manager, who's been there for a very long time, Holly, is part responsible for that magic. So it's happy to hear you say that. I have noticed that there are certain artists who it takes a little bit of time when they first arrive to get settled in. And I'm wondering if you could share your own story about a moment or an incident that sort of landed you in the space, and if anything sticks out.
I when I arrived at the Headlands, I drove directly from work. So I had packed the car the night before, drove it to school, had a closing meeting from my teaching job, and I remember running to the car like, oh God, I can't wait because I've been waiting for this for so long. So driving to Headlands, and you know, I'm bringing my stuff upstairs, running to Naeem, go to the house, running to Corey. But in the doghouse, they had a VHS player, which was amazing because like, where did they find this thing? And they had a bunch of, they also had a DVD player and a bunch of like videotapes. Again, where do they find these things? And there was one night, we got into the habit at least once a week, like people would come over to the doghouse and we watch movies. And so there was one night where we watched Magnolia. We had to, I forgot that Magnolia is such a long movie that it was broken up into two tapes. And so so there was one point where we're all sitting there watching a movie, and I sort of step back out of it and sort of look around. I was like, wow, these are my people. Like, we were all just so like engrossed with this movie, and there was like some people that hadn't seen it, some people that hadn't seen it in a long time. It's just like, and we're just all like on the same page sort of watching this movie. And it's just like, there was that kind of level of comfort where you just be your whole self there, that it's rare that I experience that like during my normal life, but also like when you go to a residency, you're able to do that. It's you just can't buy that.
How about you, Elizabeth?
Wow. As you're talking, there's so many thoughts that went through my head. I do, though, remember getting there and being really nervous. I mean, I had just gotten out of graduate school. You know, all of these amazing artists were there from, you know, all over the United States, all over the world. But I do remember, because I was from the Bay Area, I would get stuck driving the Headland cars. And I don't know if they're still like kind of in sort of semi disrepair, but like people would like donate cars, and it was great because there was a car there, and I had a truck because I'm a sculptor, which could only fit one person. So if a bunch of us wanted to go off, you know, to like go into town or something like that, we had to get into a car, one of the cars. And I remember the brakes going out on one of the cars. There was like six of us in it. And that really broke the ice. That really broke the ice. We made it to the bottom because there was like a stop sign. And I knew that if I could make a right turn without having anyone come, we would coast, you know, as you're going like over towards the tunnel. And I just remember like all of us screaming at the same time while I was trying to stop the car. And after that, I felt like I was part of like the community. Maybe it was like staring death in the face.
Near life or death experiences.
That's right.
Amazing. I do think that we have newer vehicles now.
Do you still have vehicles out there?
We do have vehicles. There's some Hondas.
Wow. That's
fabulous. They have their own little issues, but I don't think they're quite as in the same state. Great. I wonder, you know, Headlands we are very close to San Francisco proper, but you're in a national park and nature is everywhere. And so I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about what it felt like to negotiate with nature in the ways that sometimes you have to at Headlands, whether that is coyotes, whatever that means.
Well, there are the mice.
There are mice, yes.
Yeah, and luckily I live with like three other very clean people. And that was, you know, we didn't have to worry about like protecting food. Everybody washed dishes when they were done. Yeah, I had another one of my housemates who was actually working at Headlands, Morgan Ramirez, actually tried to stalk a deer one afternoon. That was kind of fun to watch. But it's, you know, at that point I'd been in the Bay Area like at least 30 years, so in and around the Bay Area, so it was like used to it. It was hot that first week when we got to Headlands, and everybody thought like, oh, this is San Francisco summer, and like the people from the area were like, no, you need a coat. It's gonna get cold later. Like don't let this fool you. I know it's June, but it's not really in the Bay Area. It's not really summer. But I just felt everything was just very manageable. Like, you know, it was cool seeing deer. It was, you know, it was nice seeing the coyotes. There's a droning sound that goes off in the distance that we're trying to figure out. We spent most of Headlands like, what is that? Is that whales? Was that the mammal wildlife center up on the hill? Like we just didn't know. But yeah.
Any nature stories for us?
You know, we already talked about the cold. I mean, one of the things I think is so interesting about Northern California is everyone says, oh, it's California. You don't need insulation. You don't need insulation in your walls. So yeah, it's really, really cold. I do remember that I was in residence with this just really extraordinary writer. And he shared with me a book of essays about mountain lion attacks.
because I would go running out there and he was sure that I was going to be attacked and eaten by a mountain lion. So I remember being a little worried about mountain lions, but on one run one time, I almost stepped on a bobcat and it was just hanging out in the middle of the path, just hanging, just looking at me. And I was like, you know, I stopped and I walked very slowly around it and continued. But it's, I mean, it's just so beautiful. I remember Annie Sprinkle and I were in residence together at the same time, and we would go out on the beaches and just lay on our backs and watch the pelicans, because you have all the pelicans come in and out. Just extraordinary. I mean, that's like one of the amazing things, is you just walk out of your studio and you're surrounded by just beauty and the ocean, you know, and the beautiful like volcanic shapes of, you know, the hills. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the really extraordinary things about it. I do remember that there was a an artist that I was also there in residence with who was from Poland, and he couldn't figure out why we always had either chicken or beef at dinner when there were so many rabbits everywhere. Like he was really upset that we couldn't go out and kill the rabbits. He's like, there's rabbits everywhere. Why aren't we eating them? That's one of the beautiful, that's really part of the magic of the place.
Well, that seems like a really good segue into a question about food. So I'm wondering about, you know, obviously Breaking Bread, the name of our program today, very important. I'm wondering if you can share some stories with us about food at Headlands.
There are so many. I mean, sometimes Chef Damien would come out and he would announce the menu and people would break into happy dances, like jumping up and down, like with excitement, like you're 12, like you're getting your favorite meal. But outside of that, again, you know, going back to community, like it provides a place for you to sit down and maybe chat a little bit longer. Get into more depth, getting to know somebody you maybe you don't see during the day. There was a peach cobbler day that was just downright sublime. It was like you had to get it in layers. You had to get the whole thing, the peach with the whipped cream. Then you had to have the like the cobbler by itself. Then, you know, you finally just like you end up with a bowl of whipped cream. And, you know, I think people stayed in there like an extra hour longer just to enjoy all this, but also like the conversation that was going on with it, you know, not necessarily about the peach cobbler, but also about just whatever was going on with their day or whatever was going on with their residency. So that that communal meal is essential just for the strength of the cohort and just for being human, just being able to talk, especially now, you know, we're sort of like in this slightly post-pandemic world, and you know, we don't get to gather as much as we used to, but you know, reflecting back on how easy it was to be able to do that and having a vehicle for that, like the food was not only just nutritious and just delightful, it was just, again, it was that vehicle for conversation.
Oh boy, I mean, we were just talking about what I say to people on the East Coast about this residency. Because I tell people, like, you need to go to the Headlands. Like, it's amazing. It's beautiful. It's, you know, it's extraordinary. The spaces are beautiful. And then, like, in the same sentence, the food is incredible. You know, it's not just the food. It's also, I think, just the way that like, the kitchen is shaped, right? Because you all do dishes, right? So it's like this whole process of, like, the food comes into being, we eat, and then there's the cleanup afterwards, which is also communal. I don't know, the food was amazing. What can I say? When I was there, the cook was Jessica Prentice, and she was very much about this idea that the kitchen was sort of the place of knowledge. And she knew all of the plants. You know, she knew all of, you know, the local food systems. I remember she fed us stinging nettles one night, and we didn't know it until we all started like chewing, because it makes your mouth like, it's, oh boy, it like it kind of makes your mouth sort of sting, I just remember it was just incredible. The other thing that I remember is that after those amazing dinners, you'd have sort of like this kind of almost, what is it called, you know, carbohydrate crash. But then you could go back for late night snacks because everything would be like, you know, put away in the refrigerator. And then you could go back at like, you know, 11 o'clock or midnight for more of that pie, right? Yeah, and also the bread baking. Yeah, it was just, it was truly extraordinary. Really amazing process.
Absolutely, and I do think that our kitchen remains, our Chef Damon remains sort of like the center of the knowledge production. He continues that tradition. So I'm wondering if you can share a little bit about sort of any rules you chose not to follow while you were at Headlands.
I have a feeling that this, well, it's, you know, it takes a while to get there. Like I was living, after graduate school, I was living in Fruitvale. I was teaching like multiple part-time lecture positions in San Francisco. So I'd drive to SF, I teach all day, and then I'd make it out to the Headlands. And if it was like a Friday night, I could get a lot of extra studio time if I slept in my studio. If I slept in my studio.
Ooh.
Yeah, I know. And both me and Annie Sprinkle were out, and this was the old missile site when you weren't supposed to sleep there. But every once in a while we would. And those mornings were just so gorgeous because I mean, I did regular residencies where you were allowed to sleep there and the mornings were just equally spectacular. But there's just something about like, you know, watching the light fill the sky over the ocean, right? And you're already out there and there's often people in the kitchen making coffee even early. And that though, it was just so beautiful to wake up there. And I always had this sense that people kind of knew that like, you know, that maybe you'd been working in your studio late. But the other sense that I got was that people were so supportive of art making. Right, that they just really wanted to support your art making. And if that you helped the art making, that was great. So that's all I'm gonna, I there's all kinds of other rules I broke, but I don't wanna talk about
it
right
okay.
now. So that's it.
Rodney?
I don't know if it was a official rule, but so the project space is on the third floor of 944. And the so I was doing this wood project and the table saw is in the next building on the bottom floor. So I'm not running up and down three flights of stairs all day to do this project I was working on. So I had a small 10-inch table saw back in my studio in San Francisco. So I just like one weekend I just went home and got it and brought it up, and I was kind of making a lot of noise during parts of the weekend. Like the Headlands staff was most of the staff was like really good about it, but one person sort of came out and said like, "Hey, you know, there's a table saw next door." It's like, "Yes, I'm well aware of that, but you know, I'm trying to work smarter, not harder." You know.
I should note that the project space is where the public is invited to come in, so that probably was also a safety for the public. No remorse.
No, it was a small table saw. It wasn't huge or anything, you know, like fit in the back of a car, you know. I wasn't running it when people came in, you know, just
okay.
Swear to God.
Okay, not too bad in both of these cases. I'm wondering if I'd love to open it up for questions, if anybody has them. And do we have a microphone situation?
Hello. First of all, thank you so much for being here. Headlands sounds such a magical place, and I'm just curious, as a mom and an educator, everything I've heard you about artists, what would you consider to be the way that we can encourage our youth? I know you're the mom of a 13-year-old, I'm the mom of a 14-year-old, my friend's also mum of a 14, 15. What can you encourage, or how can we encourage our youth to be so much more into the arts, especially in a world that is such a fast-paced world?
A big question. Who would like to take that on?
Sure. Yeah. As a former educator, and I taught middle school, take them places. Take them to the Headlands. I had students, I ran into students who didn't know I was there, that were in college at the time. They're out of college, and just, you know, and she was there with her family. I had students who knew I was there and made trips out there. But, you know, during the course of, like, you know, a child's life, if you show them how to be, or take them places, even as to, like, to an artist studio, you know, take them to open studios, or take them to exhibits or museums, especially if there's the opportunity where they can do a one-on-one and talk to an artist, or even ask them, like, a question, that always helps. You know, they can, some friends and I were talking last year, and we were watching a documentary on HBO about, it's about the art market. What's it called? The Price of Everything, or The Cost of Everything. And we were saying, like, how helpful it would have been as, like, when we were young, if somebody just would have showed us, like, these are different iterations how you can be an artist. You don't have to be this one thing. You can be many things within the art world.
That's a really great comment, because, you know, there's so many different ways to exist as an artist. Community art, you know, performative practices. You know, it's funny that you would ask, because I have a couple answers. My first thought is, and this is probably because I'm not, how do I put this? I think that maybe the less time spent on digital media, the better. That's one thought. I noticed that my son loves playing online, and he's really into it, but you get him off and he starts exploring the real world, the big wide world. And I think that the big wide world has more unusual interactions in it than you would see in a situation that has been, you know, where the architecture has already been established by a designer or some other kind of creative. So I would try to get them into situations where they're able to engage in generative practices where you don't know what's gonna happen. The other thing is, and I'm just tossing this out here, I'm a professor at Rutgers, right? And a lot of times I will only get one shot at having a student in a class. Like, maybe they're taking me because it's gen ed or something like that, and they've got to take their art and aesthetic, it's called art and aesthetic interpretations. I'm gonna take my class. And I try to get them to think like anarchists, right? Like, do not buy into other people's rules, right? Do stuff out in the world that is surprising. I try to, like, orchestrate epiphanies, right? So that they can do things that go out into the big wide world that are surprising, that then other people, situations, communities might interact with that create something else. So I think, you know, the word is experiential learning, right? Where you go and have experiences, making things, doing things out in the world. I think that's important.
I would just add that I think, especially if you're not in an environment where you are used to the arts, right, and exposed to it, mentorship is a really important thing. So encouraging that person to find kind of a mentor and continue to be curious, because it really just takes one person to sort of show you the way that this is, like, there's a path for you here. And so that would be the only thing I would add.
Hi. So I guess, whether personally or professionally, what do you feel has been your greatest triumph in your practice so far? Whether it's, like, the thing that's made you feel good, or thing that has made other people feel good, you know? Yeah.
That's a really tough question.
Of course.
That's a tough question. You don't want me to, I have some thoughts. Yeah. So I do these funny projects where I work in art, where I collaborate and do these strange things. So to get them to work is often a real achievement, like just to get them to work. I one time made a robotic plant that used AI. So it was a house plant that could, I made a bunch of them. They're called floribugs. They move around and they can freely find sunlight and water in a domestic space by themselves. That was really difficult to do. I made this other thing called a plastomatch, which is a giant vinyl stomach that actually eats plastic by virtue of living fungi. White rot fungi, the carbon chains in plastic look a lot like the carbon chains in wood. So if you give them the right environment, they will actually eat plastic, our plastic waste. So like those kinds of things. And I don't know if they make other people happy, but just getting the, you know, just getting the damn thing to work or to stand or, you know, sometimes that's like the achievement that at least I can see in an immediate kind of way.
Wow, I gotta follow that, seriously. It depends on where my head's at on any given day when I think about accomplishments. And I always make the work with an intention of educating or just starting some kind of critical dialogue with the viewer, and getting the best part for me is getting that feedback, not that it's positive, but just that it's feedback or more questions like, why did I create something? Or they didn't know a certain issue that I brought up or a piece of history I brought up. But I think when I think about achievements, and as I'm sitting here right now, the first thing that's popped in my mind is like being able to be consistent in my practice. Because there was a point where when I would apply for residencies, you know, Headlands included, that I wouldn't send in an application if I didn't have a certain amount of work done that was new between the cycles. And then I noticed that time sort of shrunk. Then it was like, oh, I can apply for this because I've been consistently doing work, or I've been consistently in my practice exploring these things. And just being able to keep that, being able to say that I'm a practicing artist and that I'm doing these things. And I'm not talking about like getting all the bells and whistles. I mean, that helps and that's important, you know, getting funding or grants, but also just being able to like understand that this is my job. And even while I was teaching art, which I was kind of in the same headspace all day as being an art teacher and art creator, but just having a consistent part of my life of being able to be in my practice, make work, put work out there, think about new ideas, collaborate with people, have a community of friends who are also artists that I could also just talk to about things, just being out there in this community and all that. That to me was probably like the one achievement I constantly think about as part of my practice.
Thanks.
So I have two questions. Is this close enough? First one is, what did you do immediately after you got out of the Headlands, artistically, that is? What did you do immediately after you got out of the Headlands, and I mean artistically? And the second question is, can you eat the rabbits? Can you eat the rabbits?
Can you eat the rabbits? You mean your question is what happened after the residency when
right.
you get out of the residency?
Immediately after, yes.
Oh boy. Well, consistency falls away rapidly. Yeah, that's one of the things. It's hard leaving a residency because you become best, like just dear, dear, deep friends with everyone that's there. So they become your day-to-day community. And when you have to leave that, it's difficult. It's really difficult. Yeah, I often find that you stop being consistent. Sometimes I get a little depressed. It's tough. It's really tough. Thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, the very first thing I did was there was a lot of tears flowing. Like, so I kind of snuck out of the house before my roommates got up. So I didn't have to, yeah. Oh,
so you didn't have to deal with that.
Yeah. Your practice gets a little bit smaller again. Like, so I had to go back to work, had a bunch of pre-meetings before I started teaching again. And then, yeah, you start planning out projects again, but then you notice like, oh, you have to plan it in between, like sleeping, working, and whatever else you have to do. So there are other projects that did get started. I fell back into my old routine of like, okay, you have a certain amount of time during the day between classes. What can you bring to school with you? What can you write from your laptop at school? What can you do at work? How much time do you have when you get home? Like, what are you gonna do on the weekend? Whereas, you know, before it was just like, we're into Headlands, let's just get up, eat, and you just go to work.
I don't wanna minimize the gift of what you get at the residency. It's just that real life it's difficult to really work. It's difficult to get a lot of work made, deep work. And sometimes I would find myself like at the Headlands working, and I would think, oh, I'm not getting anything made. Like, oh, I'm not, you know. And then I would realize afterwards that depth of time allowed me to really, you know, for me personally, find my practice, which was really difficult to figure out, like my genuine practice, right? So I don't want to minimize it. I don't want to say like, oh, you get out, it's horrible because it's the real world, because it's such a gift, right? So you know you've got this amazing gift, and sometimes it didn't even occur to me for like a number of years, actually. I would look back at what I did and I would go, wow, that's amazing. I was able to jump from like A to, you know, to D in this period of time. When the real world is like, you know, D.1, D.2, D.3, right? It's really slow. I just want to add that. And I think you could probably talk about the rabbits and the mice. Sounds like there's a lot of rodents out there that are prime for eating.
We
perhaps.
Do. Not dissimilar from the size of rodents out here, I would say. But the rabbits, I would say there are meals that we have that Damon has shared that, you know, have come from the very, very local. So more from the sea, I would say, less from the land.
Fish? You're not talking about like the mammals from the Marine Mammal Center.
We are in a national park, so we're not supposed to, you know, we're not supposed to really touch we're supposed to keep the landscape as it is. And that includes the wildlife. That's the diplomatic answer. We have time for one or two more questions.
So the Headlands is part of the San Francisco Bay Area, which is one of the whitest areas I've ever lived in. So how does Headlands support artists of color? And how do you as artists of color feel being plopped in the middle of the whitest county in California?
My original cohort was 11 people, 9 of us were people of color. So that kind of solved that problem right there. And then consequently, all the other people that came in afterwards, there was constantly a people of color presence there. And I never felt like I was out of place. There were certain things that happened there that I had experienced in other places where nobody asked me like, oh, why are you doing that kind of work, you know? Or there wasn't that kind of uncomfortable feeling like I had to sort of push my agenda. I felt like I was in a group of people, even the people there who weren't people of color just accepted like, oh, this is your practice. Like, oh, well, I would like to know more. And there was like this really even exchange. But yeah, I know it had been an issue. It had been an issue for me visiting Headlands in the past. And I had actually had some friends where people of color actually came up there, and they were really surprised that there were that many people of color up there during that year. So I'm just really happy for the Headlands as a DEI plan, and you guys are sticking to it.
Yeah, and I would just say, as you know, I came to the Headlands as a new director, first director of color, at a moment when the pandemic, we were in complete lockdown. So, and I'm new to the West Coast. So there was a lot of getting settled in this space. And I found that the way that I approached it was to be really transparent of when I was feeling uncomfortable, or something was just new, you know, because I'm originally from the Midwest and then had spent some time here in New York. There was actually more country mouse city girl, I would say, issues that I ran into, rather than, you know, and that might just be the way that I move in the world. I try to just own the difference that I experience. But I definitely noticed it, just to say that. I will say that I have, part of the reason that I came to Headlands was because I was so impressed with the work that they have done as an organization, thinking about these issues of diversity and equity that preceded this 2020 George Floyd moment. You know, I think that our previous program director, Sean Uhara, very naturally was on the lookout for these issues of making sure that we had a diverse cohort without being without sort of necessarily sounding sounding the horn about it and tuning his horn about it all the time. And now we're in the process of putting in place like what are some very specific actionable items that we should be taking to address that, just to make sure that that's in the fabric of the organization rather than just allowing it to happen because of certain people who, you know, are moving that work forward. So I feel proud of what we're doing in terms of that and that piece and how we're really thinking about the nine counties of the Bay Area as our sort of local. Thank you for that question.
I also just wanted to respond to that great question, which is, I remember there was a moment where I was like, Mari, I think we did this over text message. I was like, are we the first Black and Brown people to lead this organization? Ooh, what an opportunity. Like, that is so exciting. We're so excited about that. And it was actually a conversation with a local Black artist that was a tipping point for me as I was asked to consider the role to chair the board. And I've done that before, and I was like, I don't need another job. But it was a conversation with that artist talking about representation in the Bay Area community and how there needed to be a change there that actually really convinced me that I should do this. So I'm excited about it. I'm excited about what Headlands is doing. I'm excited about the people that are there. I ran into one of our artists on the street today who's based in DC. What a wonderful coincidence. Like, we are everywhere now, actually. So I hear what you're saying, and Headlands is doing it.
Okay. So we are actually, we have traveled to here with some wonderful treats from our Headlands Kitchen in the hopes of basically continuing this idea of community and breaking bread together. So I'd like to actually say goodbye to our live audience and transition to our reception, which is gonna be just at the top of this stairwell. We have Chef Damon sourdough bread for all of you, and we have cultured butter. if that's your thing, and we have some other treats for us to share. So we'll have a reception and we're welcome to sit and chat and talk more. I want to thank both of you, Elizabeth and Rodney. Thank you for your generosity in this conversation and for just being amazing stewards for this community. So, and if you could all join me and just